Okay, hi, it's Matt from Brigantes here, and we're going to talk about the new stove going in service with the Royal Marines, and it's the Optimus Polaris. Now, in front of me, you can see a few of the bits and bobs, and I'll talk to you about them and what they actually do. So starting off, in the pan here, and there's a very, very good reason why I've put it in the pan. So when you're storing the stove, keep it inside the pan and it will protect the stove. There's nothing wrong with that because the stove does not leak fuel. All you have to do is pull a couple of different things and it is a completely dry stove. All right. So if we go into the pan here, I'll put that to one side. And you see in the bag is, so it's like a little canvas bag, and the stove is kept within this canvas bag. So it comes out here and it's all, and this is down in its collapsed state. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to open up the stove. And there are three legs, okay, and then a control arm as well. So one, two, three gives you a really, really stable platform. You can peg this down to stop it wobbling about if you want, but you don't need to. You've then got an armored cable, which is the fuel hose, and then the valve adapter, which will then go either onto gas or liquid fuel. You do not need to change this in any way, shape or form. You do not need to change the jet on the inside. And if you look on the inside there, you can see a little brass screw, and in there is a small, really, really small aperture. That is where the fuel comes out of. Also in the bottom here, you can see there is a wick, which is like a fibrous material. So you do not need to use any burning paste. You need to do anything like that at all. It will do its pre-warming for you. It's a much simpler stove in that regard. On the top is the burner head. Now this can pop off, and it's designed to do that so you can service it correctly. You know, if it's not there, if it's come away, just clip it back on and away you go. It's really, really not a problem. It is not a fault. Okay, so what I'm going to show you first, I'm going to show you how to use the gas. So the gas is good to around about minus 15. And it's a really, really low carbon monoxide level. And actually, it is probably available in most places you'll be going. This is the main fuel source for lightweight stoves within the UK. In this bottle, I have Coleman fuel, or essentially, for you guys, it would be naphtha, but it works in exactly the same way as your liquid fuel. Okay, so stove's always set to go. What I want to do, first of all, is I'm going to make sure this is closed, so righty-tighty, it's fine. Don't crank it, just give it a nice little nudge. And essentially what you've got down here is a pin that looks very, very like a firing pin. And that goes in and that's just all shut down. So if I take the cap off this, you see here there's two little wire elements and these are legs or feet. So we'll just pop them out. And this helps when it's a cold environment. So butane propane. I can never get it the right way around which one has the lower freezing point, but essentially in cold weather, one becomes a liquid or becomes is burns before the other. So what we do is we turn it upside down. So liquid wants to obviously go down into the pipe. So it's just a simple screw on. Screw it as far as it goes, just really gentle, and that'll be a nice seal. Now, so let's see what we've got here. We're all attached. This is this way around. Now, couple of things to point out on this particular stove, on this particular gas canister, has a number of safety features on it. So if you look underneath, there is a bevel on it, I suppose, the best way to call it. That is designed that if this heats up, this pops and it becomes more like a rugby ball. If it then continues to heat further, it pops off. So this is not an explosive canister. And I've had my own experiences with explosive canisters. So you don't need to worry about that. It's a very, very safe canister. Okay, so we're now all good to go. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pull in a Moroccanif, which you'll probably see and come across. And in there is a fire lighter. So I'm gonna light this using a fire lighter. Okay, so with the control arm, I'm gonna just turn it a little bit. If I can do it. That's light. using a flint and steel, just to show that it can be done. And that's a very, very efficient stove. And you can hear it burning now, and you see it burning with a really, really clean blue flame. And we can ramp it right up. You hear it going. You notice how as it's warmed up a little bit more, it's burning better still. So I'm going to turn that off. Good old lighter. So again, exact same thing, really, really easy. No need to mess around. Just turn it on. You'll hear the gas coming out. And away you go. Now you notice what I did there was I actually moved the lighter lower down here. You can't do that with a flint and steel, and there's gaps here which make it a little bit easier to light. Okay, so switching that one off. So in reverse, we've done our cooking, we're putting it away. Just go directly to the control arm, turn it to the right, and it will turn off. That is it. There is no fuel in it. It's absolutely clean. Removing it, turn it back the right way around, and then just twist off the gas canister. Don't worry if it hisses a bit, it's just the seal on the gas canister going from there. So that is fine, that's all clear. That is all clear, there is no fuel in there at all. Okay, so that is gas. Okay, the next one we're gonna look at is liquid fuel. So liquid fuel, and it will burn any liquid fuel here. So whether it's diesel, petrol, alcohol-based, whatever, it is the same. With the dirtier fuels, it will, as the name suggests, burn dirtier, and it will get things a lot blacker, and you may need to clean it a bit. Now, I don't have one of the tools here, but it comes with a little spanner which has a magnet on it. And if you run the tool underneath, you'll hear it just click. And it, do you remember with the old stove, we used to have to proddle the hole? You don't need to, that's built into it already. So here we are, all set up, we've got everything good to go. We're sat in our tent, probably. First thing we do is we're going to attach the fuel bottle. And what you do is you screw this on here. And what you'll notice on the top of the cap here, there is an on and there is an off. So with the off facing up, no fuel can go down this pipe. And basically all it is on the inside is the fuel line is facing out of the fuel. So there is not too much fuel. You need to make sure there's a space in the fuel tank as you would do with the old stove, and you can see the dotted line. So the first thing we're gonna do is gonna work from this end to light it. So obviously we need to go from off to on, and we need to pressurize this. So we're gonna do 20 pumps, it says. And a few extra just for good luck. There you are, feel a little bit of pressure. I'm now gonna turn that to on. Just check that this is closed off. So now that is on, the fuel line is now into the fuel in the lower part of the bottle. You see this little tap here. Now actually this was added on due to US sort of rules. It worked perfectly fine with the old bottles, and I used to use one of these in Norway in 2006. So it's perfectly workable technology. But anyway, this is on off to the right. So we need to turn that on. Okay, so we turn that on. Now what we're going to do next is we're going to preheat the stove. Now to do that, all we do is we just turn it the right way, open up the valve, and you'll start to see and hear a little bit of fuel, he says, go into the stove. Okay, if that's the case, a few more pumps. Okay, let's try that again. makes a funny little squirting noise and puts a little bit of fuel in the bottom there. Now this will take a little bit of practice. We're outside at the moment, but what you do, put a little bit of fuel in and then light it. Now that starts a really little flame. You don't want too much fuel. If you speak to certain other people, they go, yeah, put a load of fuel in, let it build up and then burn down. Not good in a tent. You see how we've just got a nice little fuel, nice little flame burning, and that's burning the fuel in the base of the stove, and it's heating up the brass tube because it conducts heat really nicely. And what we're going to do is going to leave that for a few seconds to burn down. And as you can see it burning down, we're just going to open up the valve a little bit. And we're going to use it really, really gently. We're just going to bleed it in. And what we'll do is it gets, as it gets hotter, the pressure increases. PV equals NRT. And it'll start to go. You can hear it start to roar now. And as it gets more and more pressurized, the yellow will go away and the blue will come in. There you are. That's all going absolutely fine. And you can hear it roaring away, no problem at all. So the control arm can actually give you very, very fine control of the stove and of the flame. So just back it off a little bit, get it to the right place, but essentially just let it crack on. So you're there, you do your heat up your water, you melt your snow, whatever you need to do. So then to shut it off, this is where it is, this is how you make it a dry system. So go back to the bottle and it's on. What you're gonna do is you're gonna turn it to off. Now that takes the fuel line out of the fuel and this stove will start to use up all the fuel left in the system. So you just let it burn. This is when you'll find out if you've put too much fuel in the bottle or not. Quite interesting, because what this does show, it shows how efficient the burner is at using the fuel, and it will go for quite some time. So there we are, so it's just shut off. Now what that has done is completely dried, bled all the fuel out of this system. So you can hear it, and you can let the pressure go away. Now the other reason for letting it, or the pressure go away, and it'll stop making a sort of a hissing noise, is that when you then, if you need to release this, then it doesn't squirt everywhere as well. So it's still just depressurizing, getting less and less. Cool, so now that's done, what we do is we work from the stove back. So we're gonna turn that, close it down, so turn it all the way to the right. We're gonna turn this to off. And then we're gonna undo, if I can get it the right way around, undo the valve there. Now that can then go away back in your kit and there's no fuel coming out, completely dry, so you get no contamination. No problem with leaving this in here, it's quite a robust little thing. But there you are, really nice, simple. Okay, what happens when it goes wrong? And I'll show you how not to do it. Now it'll start a lot quicker this time because there's already heat within the pipes. So let's pump it up. Let's turn it to on. Let's turn that to on. Okay, right, I'm gonna put too much fuel here. If it will. So it's coming through the pipe at the moment and it should start to squirt out. I think it's probably already atomized. There we are, right, okay. Fuel's coming out, we're gonna let it have plenty of fuel. Right. If my lighter works, that is. that's better. Okay, so we've got it burning. What if we start to just smash it and put on there? So if, let's open it up. So you see how you get a big yellow flame. Now, a couple of things you can do here. Actually, if you just leave it to burn, it will die down. So you don't need to panic at all. So we just let it crack on. And slowly it will pressurize the system. When it's a colder system, you'll get a much bigger effect on that. You can have quite a big flame. So hence why I show you the way to do it the way before. There you are. So it's all now behaving nicely. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn it off the wrong way and you'll see what happens. So instead of doing the bottle over and letting it drain, I'm going to just turn it off here. Okay, brilliant. Turn that to off. Now it may squirt out fuel on here as well. Yeah, so straight away we've got some fuel coming out of the valve. You can see the fuel coming out of the fuel pipe. Yeah, not a huge amount, but fuel nonetheless. So that is the difference between letting it dry out and burn through and letting it and doing it the other way. So let's just do this and relight it. So we need to let move the air through and then let the fuel come through. And you'll see it coming up through the jet. It smells a little bit like Slivovitz or Schnapps. Come on. Right, here comes the fuel. That's good. So remember, fuel comes out, turn it off. Don't light it before. Come on, a little bit more, a little bit of wind. Okay, so that's lighting, that's now heating through. Turn it on, we've got a nice blue flame. Well, gone a bit yellow there. So let it just heat through. Just back it off a bit and it will catch up. We just keep the flame nice and low and in control. There's a lot of control available on the control arm. And then we just bleed a little more fuel in. So what it's doing, the heat is basically atomizing and vaporizing that fuel as soon as it comes out. What they've done, which is really, really clever, is they've managed to find an optimal hole that will take all of the fuels. A lot of the other stoves in the market, you'll need to change the aperture or you'll need to change the valve here. Okay, so that's now going, and then we'll turn it off and make sure it's all dry properly. So again, turn that to off, and then we just be patient, warm our hands, keep the temp warm, whatever it is we need to do. But it's a very, very efficient stove, and you can see this here, so you will need to use a lot less fuel than you're used to. Steady away. Once you get efficient with this, then it becomes a very, very slick system. The other thing to point out, on the bottom of this pan, you know, it's a flat bottom. It's not got a heat exchanger. Heat exchangers massively increase carbon monoxide, massively increase. So do not use a pan with a heat exchanger on the bottom. They do speed up your cooking time, obviously, but you then get a real problem there. But it's going now. You can see it just started to pulse and flicker, and then out it goes. So on the top of that, Obviously, I'm just letting the pressure drain away. You can see there's a little bit of carbonisation on the top of the sort of the guard at the top, but other than that, it's pretty clean, frankly. So you're not going to get loads of soot over your kit. You don't tend to get a load of soot on the bottom of your pan unless you're using it incorrectly. So blue flame, good flame; yellow flame, dirty flame. Okay, so we're going to turn that off now. Okay, I won't shut that down. I say I'm going to turn that one off as well. And then I'm going to go through it. There we are. Nice and simple. Now, you will need to let it cool down a little bit. This will be hot, obviously. The legs are fine. So, and you'll notice they've also got a bit of a sort of a texture to the top of them, so your pan doesn't slide around as much. So just let that cool down for a little bit, and then, as we did before, collapse the arm in, legs in, and they need a little bit of pressure. You're not going to break it, so don't worry about it. And then, back inside the bag, and back inside your pan, and then that goes back in your rucksack. Or your Bergen or whatever, and away you're good to go.